Okay, welcome at the Seminus IX event, the virtual Seminus IX event in Enkhuizen. Welcome on this wonderful day in September. I'm Meindert Boon. I'm head of Brassica breeding in EMEA. Together with a team of scientists and breeders, we develop varieties in cabbage, cauliflower and broccolis. I'm going to tell something about the key objectives and targets in our broccoli and cauliflower breeding program. Well, of course, it's important that we as breeders breed for varieties which meet customer needs. What's important in a breeding program? One of the key targets is stability of performance. And why is this so important? Nowadays, with climate change and what we also see today, very sunny, we have a lot of issues with temperature swings, erratic rainfalls, etc., etc. And it's important that we develop gene pools which are adapted to all those conditions. And good adapted gene pool is the basis of a good breeding program. From these gene pools, we develop lines which are the basis for hybrids and new varieties, which I will show later here in the field. We have in Bayer a global breeding program, and we have testing facilities all over the globe. To highlight, we have in Nam, we have in San Juan Batista a breeding location. We have breeding locations in Europe, and for example, here we are in Enkhuizen. This is a good breeding location because we are in an environment of brassicas. We can select against diseases. In Wageningen, we have a breeding location where we look at heat tolerance. In South Europe, in Spain, we have locations where we look for stress, winter and cold stress tolerance, or varieties which perform from cool to warm and warm to cool. Besides these testing facilities where we test our hybrids, we have extensive testing programs. That means that with the gene pools we develop lines, and from these lines we develop hybrids. It starts in the first year with thousands and thousands of hybrids, which we test in a few environments, which are, let's say, comparable to the global environments. From these thousands and thousands of hybrids, we test, we select a set of 10% of the hybrids, so a few hundred. They will move to the next year of testing. In this next year of testing, we have more test locations where we look at our varieties. We collect more data in more environments. Again, this will filter out the better performers. Then, a year after, in year three, we are going to test at far more locations and we are going to scale up the seed production. That gives an indication of how producible varieties are. And together with, let's say, results and the data which we collect on 30 to 40 test locations and environments, we are going to select a very small set of hybrids which go pre-commercial, and then our MD organization is going to look which pre-commercial ones can will become or have the ability to become a commercial variety. Well, looking at this total program from gene pool development till introduction, for broccoli it can take 12 to 15 years depending on the trait. In cauliflower it can take up to 20 years also depending on the trait. What are, besides this adaptability, some traits we are looking at, some selection criteria? We look at yield, of course, that's very important for our growers. Besides yield, we look at disease packages. And Mark Ermers from Crop Protection will have a separate story about this, what their solution is for that. We look at plant structure, curd head quality, uniform and predictable harvest. And later, Karsten Rienstra will tell our sales advisor, will tell us something about the tool they develop, a very nice tool, which can predict harvests, which actually meet with our varietal requirements. Innovative solutions, there comes the creativity of a breeder. Anticipate on future trends. We have innovative programs in cauliflower, in broccoli. For instance, in cauliflower we have the Curdivex program, in broccoli we have the High-Rise program. Besides those, we also look at customer convenience, and some examples are, for instance, Bella Verde or floretting broccoli. And yeah, to go a little bit more in detail, I want to start with broccoli, a little bit more specific. Well, you can all read the green bar, what the key target is, and the selection criteria. And in a few minutes, I'm going to show you some hybrids, which are the result of our breeding program. stability of performance, that's important. I thought about that. Yield is important. There are specific needs. Some markets look for a minimum of 500 grams. If you look at processing, they look at a recoverable yield from florets. In our American markets, in NAM, they look at numbers of boxes to the acre. So there are a lot of specifications in yield. Head shape, an important thing. Nice dome heads we want, but why? Because nice dome heads provide that the water drains out very fast, so that prevents heads from getting bacterial substrate, for instance. Color is important, head position is important. A little bit exerted head helps for a better airflow, and which means that the head dries up faster and then avoid getting diseases. Head firmness, stem quality, I'm going to show it there. And before we go there, I think we have to talk a little bit more about our innovations. In broccoli, we have developed a trait which is called High Rise. And under this brand, we are developing new varieties which are extremely uniform, have very clean stem, exerted heads, and are easy to harvest, which help growers to reduce on labor costs. And also by, for instance, having cleaner stems, we have better shelf life of this product. Let's have a look in the varieties, in the broccoli varieties. So we start with one of our customer and consumer friendly or convenient products. That's Sipsy, that is under the Bella Verde. When you top it, when you wait a little bit longer, the side shoots grow out like this. And when you look at this, this is actually the end product. So very nice, uniform small florets, clean stems, tasty, and for customers convenient. Other steps we are looking at, other products we are looking at is floretting product, and I'm going to put on my gloves. This is an example of a floretting type. Well, when you compare it, but when you compare a normal one, when you floret a normal one in the kitchen, I mean, you have, well, it's a kind of quite some work, and you see also the florets a little bit yellow discoloring and green in the middle. Well, with this product, let's say this is, and this is part of our high-rise program, you see it has the clean stem, but also you see separate florets, which is very important because the light can enter and then the florets are far more uniform green. Also, the stems are longer. This is actually a very tasty part. And also this product, and it allows to different packaging. For instance, you can shrink wrap this and put it as a shelf. And for preparation, have this nice about the convenient products. I want to go to the high-rise program. This is a normal broccoli. You can see that here is the head deep in the canopy and a lot of leaves. So yeah, I mean, what growers do, they take off the leaves for harvest. And you can imagine that's a lot of work, and also the stems damage. We developed a high-rise type, and this is Eiffel. This is actually a variety that works well in North American markets, and you already can see that the stem is far more clean. Also, it requires less leaf trimming. So, and I can tell you, harvest crew love the product because you know you can harvest it very fast, clean stems. It has a very nice crown, and it's a very good uniformity. And a very good uniformity means that growers need less harvest passes. So with less harvest passes, you save labor. And also you have the ability to consider a single machine harvest. Varieties. Ironman. I talked about adaptability. Ironman is a good example of a variety which performs well over the globe. And many markets, it performs like this. It's a very nice dome variety, good uniform beet, can handle some heat. hollow stem tolerant and actually very heavy, and it make the 500 gram specs. That's one. Then we're going to step a little bit further. I'm going to show you some products which are new in the high-rise program. And we have here an example of a new variety in high-rise. And this is for in North Europe for early autumn and autumn markets. Compare it a little bit with Ironman. It has a very good disease package and it's a high-rise type. Very clean, good clean stem, nice dome head, good disease package. Good disease packages against systemic downy mildew. Improvement over Alternaria. So that's a new introduction in the high-rise. Another product I want to highlight is Andersia. Andersia is developed as a high-rise, and we have seen that it can make an enormous weight. And what processors like about it is that because of the high yield, but also the florid structure is very nice. In processing, they are looking at some florid specs, and of course yield is important there. And just to show you a little bit about the florid structure, which is actually very uniform, and it can grow up to in some conditions to 750 grams or a kilo even. So it are very nice dense florets. It's in Poland and in Scotland where it's grown, and we have good feedback on that. 1002 I want to highlight. It's a variety, a transition variety between Ironman and steel. It has a good disease package, a nice dome head. It's not a high rise. It's from an earlier development, but it fits very well in this transition slot. Then, what's important? Introduced last year, Shard is performing very well in South Europe, where it performs in December harvest. It's a very heavy and very uniform variety. It's in the high. It's I can pick one. You can see well in periods when you come from cool to warm. Sorry? Yeah? Okay. This variety I cut is titanium. It's a variety developed for South Europe, and it also works in areas like where we have processing markets. It can grow very big. It has a very fine bead. It performs well in South Europe in markets, and it's mainly for February, March and April markets. And it's a high-rise product, very uniform and high yield again. Yeah, okay, we're gonna walk back, and I'm going to tell something about cauliflower. And start a little bit about cauliflower. I put this one here. Okay. In cauliflower, we are also working at adaptability. I'm going to the pointer. Sorry, yeah. So cauliflower, key targets is there also, develop stable performing varieties which are labor saving and which are available and adaptable for markets in early, main and late. Selection criteria. In cauliflower, what's very important over there is fertilization. Fertilization is actually making a cauliflower contributes to stability of performance. Uniform fertilization means uniform harvest. And nowadays also what I explained about having this temperature swings, for instance, during curd initiation when fertilization is important, is that this can cause issues in cauliflower by quality deficiency. So also in our breeding program, we are testing our varieties in various environments, and this helps us to select for varieties which are stable and which have a good fertilization. Then the next point is that harvest predictability. Karsten again will talk about the harvest planner. It's important that the cauliflower sticks to its growing days. Curd color, uniform white curd color is important. Curd firmness, curd should be nice closed, no holes, good firm florets. And yeah, other kinds of plant structure is important because that enables an easy harvest. And that's a grower can go easily through the rows, and an upright plant is easier for harvest. Disease package, we are looking in Enkhuizen at, for instance, downy mildew, alternaria, and other leaf diseases. Tolerance to physical disorders, mainly related to fertilization. When you have cold during fertilization, you can have bracting. When it's too warm during fertilization, delay, or let's say curds which are ricey or have fuzziness. What is our innovative solution in Curdivex? Or sorry, in cauliflower. I already told the name, that's Curdivex. Curdivex varieties are varieties which have stay white capacity. I will explain a little bit on that when we walk to the varieties. Stay white capacity, that's from breeding perspective, that is quite complex. It has a very complex inheritance, so we have been working on that for many years. And uniformity of fertilization again, so that allows growers to have less harvest passes. Plant type is a little bit different in Curdivex. We are looking at less wrapped types, so the curd is slightly exposed, not too much, but just enough to identify whether a curd can be harvested, yes or no. And then, because this product has stay white capacity, also in the retail it's stay white. So that means a reduce of waste, and that's that contributes to sustainability. I will have a next slide, in which because I don't have this variety in the field, I want to highlight semi-tropical types we have. That's Marmorex and Lucex. And Marmorex and Lucex are actually varieties adapted for South Europe, mainly Italy, where they allow that you can plant in the heat. And when you plant in the heat, then you have an early high quality harvest in early fall. For the others, and I'm going to show, we start with Vitex. We go to the field and I'm going to show you the attributes of Vitex. This is a good example of, I harvested two curds of Vitex. And this is a normal variety. So this variety has the stay white trait, and this variety, this is a normal cauliflower where you, it's obvious where you can see the color difference. Well, Vitex has been introduced in the UK in 2018, and with good feedbacks. Plant type is very vigorous. Curd is nice deep. I'm going to show that on this one. This one has been planted early June. And just show you a little bit the product. So you can see it's a nice deep curd, good color, good firm. So upright plant type, uniform harvest. So again, this helps growers to save on labor costs and on harvest costs. It's going to show, I mean, we start with Vitex, but we are going to expand the range, of course. And I want to show you some new products. Some are a little bit over mature, that's normal. And some are maybe not mature yet, but let's start with this. This is the 7104. This is also in our Curdivex range. It's a very early variety. We have seen, for instance, that in areas where we have high temperatures during fertilization, it fertilizes very good and it has a very uniform harvest. So again, it's a little bit out of slot. We need to see it in summer, but it gives you an impression of how a variety like this looks. 7104. It's still under test, and well, it has to go to some testing phases before we are going to continue. Cauliflower 3, this is the 7127, a variety, and I said we are going to expand the range and we are going to develop varieties for all over the season. That one is for summer, this one is for early autumn. It's not yet ready. It has a very nice plant type, very uniform, very healthy. I cannot show you yet one, I mean, but you can see that the inner wrap, that's a very good plant type, easy to walk through. This is commercial variety. This is Fortaleza, and yeah, you can see the difference between the stay wide capacity of the Curdivex varieties and Fortaleza. We are going to walk a little bit. Cauliflower 2, this is a little bit over mature, but you can see this is a very big head. This is the 7133. Performs well in spring and autumn. Uniform harvest, firm curd, and as you can see, the very firm florets and a very good and upright plant type. There is one last variety I want to show. That's not an Curdivex type, but that's something in our a variety in our normal range, but it's good to show. It's an early variety, so it's a little bit over mature. I pick here the late one. It's quite unique because it's a variety which performs well in summer, and it has also a very good wrap. And here is an example of this variety. This is the 6041. You can see that it has a good wrap. And that's for summer production. So that's what I can tell about our varieties in cauliflower, about our varieties in broccoli. And I think we are going to switch over now to the tent again, where Mark and Karsten will tell something about crop protection and about the harvest planner. Okay, good. Thank you very much for listening. And I think we are going to hand it over. Okay, watch out. Q&A, okay. I'm sorry, I was too fast. It's time for some questions. That's with life.
Meinert, we have a question from the audience.
Yes.
How are you going to adapt to automation of harvest?
So, well, what I thought about broccoli, for instance, we have the high-rise program over there. I think that's unique because for automation we are aiming at single harvests, so one harvest pass. And in broccoli, for instance, Eiffel, I showed you, that's a very uniform variety. The breeding lines we use are extremely uniform, and also the characteristics help. I'm with the clean and elongated, a little bit exerted head that a harvest machine can easily pick those varieties. And in cauliflower, for instance, yeah, I mean, there it's probably some steps to go, but I think if you talk about automation or saving on labor, the Curdivex will help on that because, yeah, I mean, it requires no, let's say, covering. Plants are a little bit exposed, so that contributes to labor saving and easy harvest.
We have another one. We see that climate is constantly changing. How are you adapting your products to that change?
So we have a global we have global gene pools. We have Bayer is a company who have, let's say, research breeding stations at many locations over the globe in many environments. So with our gene pool, we develop this gene pool, let's say, in all those environments. So that means that if the data indicate that lines are adapted to, let's say, climate X or another climate, then we use this data to develop hybrids from those lines. And then back to that, next step is, of course, besides this gene pool development, to test these varieties under all those conditions. And we have many locations. Besides the breeding locations, next step is, of course, that we go to a pre-commercial phase where we are going to trial these varieties and grow it.